Hey everyone, and welcome back to the Farmhouse on Boone YouTube channel. My name is Lisa. If you are new to my channel, I am a blogger over at farmhouseonboone.com. A couple years into my blog, I decided to make a YouTube channel and start sharing recipes and life here on YouTube. For those of you who already know me, you probably have already heard that. Now I'm going to be taking you with me along in my kitchen and my home over the next day and a half and do some homemaking. It's still winter. These kind of videos I at least enjoy from other creators, and then I enjoy making them because we're still just in the thick of it as far as winter goes, waiting for the sunlight to come back. And one of my favorite ways to get through that is with creative homemaking. Now I'm not gonna attempt my Italian accent because it is not good, but I'm gonna attempt a sourdough panettone here in my kitchen. This is a dough that I'm getting going tonight, and then tomorrow I will complete it and take you along with me. The recipe is 4 cups bread flour, 4 eggs, 3/4 cup water, 1/2 cup of active bubbly sourdough starter, 2/3 cup sugar, 1 teaspoon salt, 2 teaspoons of vanilla, and then 12 tablespoons of butter. There's also going to be a fruit component, but I'm going to show you how I do that later. For now, I am just getting going the part of the dough that needs to do its first rise. This is traditionally done at a lower temperature than room temperature. I am doing mine a little different because it's sourdough, so I don't have fast rising, quick rising yeast to work with here. And so this dough needs a little bit more time at room temperature to rise properly. Now, I actually want to make a video all about sourdough timing. It's on my list, but the easiest way to explain this to you is just by showing it in action. I oftentimes will throw things in the fridge if I make them at the wrong time or it just doesn't line up. It's not something I think about a lot beforehand. It's something that I will do on the fly. So anyways, with this dough, I left it at room temperature for a few hours, popped it in the fridge for a few more hours, and then before I went to bed, I brought it back out. This way, it would have time to rise, but not too much time. I figured if I put it in the fridge, it would slow it down a little bit, and then it would take it a while to come back at room temperature so that if I wanted a 6-hour room temperature rise, if I got it really cold, I could put it on the countertop while I slept, and then that would probably be about equivalent. It really worked out. This panettone, as you're gonna see later in the video, turned out. Okay, as you can tell now, it is the next day, or maybe you can't tell, and I have a little organizing project to do. I wasn't planning on doing this project, but a certain child, I'm not really sure how this happened to be completely honest, spilled an entire cup of orange juice into one of these drawers, meaning that I had to get everything out of the drawer and clean it. And it was an extremely full drawer that got me thinking, why do we have so many rings and lids in here? This happens in our rings and lids drawers because we end up getting more jars for milk and then we don't get rid of the lids that come with it. Ultimately, we don't need that many. So I packed away rings in one Ziploc bag and lids in another, and I'm going to put them down in the basement. I'm trying to see how few we can get away with drinking smoothies, with milking, and then if we need more, I'll get them. And then also obviously when summer canning time happens, if I decide to can a lot, we still have them, but I'm not shuffling around in these drawers, which makes zero sense. So we have smoothie lids and straws, fermenting lids and weights in the little box in the back, and then we have lids in the other drawer. These will fill up again, I'm sure, somehow, but for right now, they are feeling tidy and nice, and I know that whenever I open these drawers, it won't overwhelm me, and I can find exactly what I'm looking for. Taking a break from this homemaking video to tell you about today's video sponsor, Birch Living. We love Birch Living here in our home. They make organic and natural mattresses. I know when I first started looking into organic mattresses, at first it sounded kind of funny. Like, why does it matter? I'm not going to be eating the mattress. But then I learned about all of the off-gassing that happens with the traditional or the conventional modern production of mattresses that off-gasses while you're sleeping. And so once I started looking into that, I realized that since we spend about 1/3 of our lives asleep, our kids at this stage of their life spend more than 1/3 of their day asleep, it is really important to be selective about the materials that go into the space where we sleep. And that is why I feel so confident in sleeping on Birch Living and recommending it to you. Birch Living mattresses are made right here in America and are crafted with organic and natural materials that have been sustainably sourced. Unlike synthetic mattresses, the wool in these mattresses make it hypoallergenic. It's both allergen and mildew resistant. Now, we really love the Birch Luxe mattress in our cottage. We have the queen size. We also have the, not the Luxe, but just the regular Birch mattresses in our boys' rooms. The Birch Luxe is a premium upgrade to their original well-loved Birch natural mattress. We also have the topper. The Birch Luxe mattress is comprised of 8 layers of organic cashmere, organic wool, organic cotton, and 100% natural latex, and it also features an added quilted organic cotton pillow Euro top and a natural non-toxic latex that relieves pressure points. With your Birch mattress, you get a 100 night sleep trial along with a 25 year warranty. I love my Birch mattress and I know that you would too. If you're looking for a new bed, check out Birch. You can click the link below or go to birchliving.com/farmhouse and get 20% off your mattress plus 2 free pillows. If you're looking for a mattress for your little ones, also be sure to check out the Birch Kids line. Thank you so much to Birch Living for sponsoring today's video. Last night before going to bed, I got a cup of dried fruit in a small dish with a half a cup of water. I did a combination of currants, golden raisins, and cranberries. Cherries also are really good in this. And then this morning when I got up, I put the dough quickly into the refrigerator so that it would be easier to shape. This same thing applies with brioche, challah, babka. If you go straight into shaping it, which I've also done, so that works too. It's a lot more difficult because the butter, it has a lot of butter in it, of course, these enriched doughs do. They can get kind of greasy and more difficult to handle. So I spread it out in a large rectangle, added my fruit. Now, traditionally, I'm sure a lot of you are like, wait a minute, if you've done this kind of baking, you are supposed to add some rum to the fruit whenever soaking it. I just did not have any rum, so I did just do water. I know that isn't exactly right. Another traditional addition is candied lemon or orange peel. This is typically made around Christmas, but it is sometimes made around Easter too. And I did not get to it a few months ago, so we're doing it now, and maybe you'll bookmark this for next Christmas, or maybe you'll make it for Easter, or maybe you just enjoy watching me make stuff, which I think is probably normally the case. I love experimenting in my kitchen. So when I hear about things like candied orange peel, I get really excited to try it out. You can also purchase candied orange peel. It's really simple to make though. Basically, you, of course, peel off the orange. You don't wanna go too far into the bitter part. So where the white part is on the orange, you wanna avoid that as much as possible. But I just use a little peeler and then cut it into strips and then create a syrup out of sugar and water to cook the orange peels in and a bit of vanilla for additional flavor. You wanna allow it to cool and then you can also add the cooked orange peels to a little sugar so that they're less sticky, and then it gives it that candied effect. It does have a lot of sugar. However, there's very little of it in the final product. It's really interesting how much the orange peel flavor goes throughout the entire dish, even though most of the time you're not getting a bite with any of the orange peel in the final product. It infuses throughout the dough. I don't know if that happens because during the second rise or if it's during the baking, but Luke and I both agreed that you taste that very delicate but yet ever-present flavor of orange all throughout the entire final product. It is really so delicious. Especially this would just be such a perfect taste at Christmas time, but also for Easter. I off to experimenting with something else. We're going to be making a jalapeno cheddar sourdough loaf. So I am taking my no-knead loaf, which is my basic loaf that I basically adapt to all of these different flavors. I've shared it on here a lot with a lot of the different ways that I make variations of it. And adding to that, I have some fermented jalapenos, which obviously baking jalapeno or baking something fermented does take away the benefits of fermenting, but it has a pickled flavor. So you can use fresh jalapenos or you can use something that's been fermented or pickled, and cheddar cheese. I'm going to get those chopped and shredded while my orange peels continue to cook so I can move on to my bread here shortly. I got my panettone dough into the mold and I'm performing my first stretch and fold on the dough that is going to be the sourdough cheddar loaf. While these things are rising, so with the bread dough, I will do a stretch and fold every 20-ish minutes and then the panettone just has to rise until it reaches the top of the mold. I am going to sit down while that's all happening in between time and do some spring ordering. I have some things I want. I want seeds for the garden. I want some tubers for dahlias. And then we need new chicks this year. We avoided chicks last year because we had so many eggs. But with the way that the farm works, if we don't order chicks this year, then the chicks that we had from, let's see here, 2 years ago will be about 3 years whenever these finally start laying. I might have done my math wrong, but hens only lay so long. So if you're not constantly replenishing your flock, then you will run out of eggs. Even whenever it seems like you're super secure, you have so many eggs, the very next year you might not have any at all if you hadn't replenished. And so you can quickly get years behind. Now, I am going to share with you shortly here what I ended up adding to my cart as far as seeds go. I struck out on the chicken thing. So apparently I needed to order a long time ago. It's no big deal. I can definitely go to my local Orchland or Tractor Supply and do their chick days. But I really wanted to order some more like olive eggers and black copper marans for the really dark colors and the olive color eggs. But they always do have Americanas, which are beautiful blue egg layers, or green. at the local feed store, and that's what we're going to have to do. So I will be getting chicks, but I was unable to order them this time. Okay, for the second stretch and fold for this dough, which I just have been setting my timer while I'm over here ordering things, I am adding the shredded cheese and the jalapenos, and then I'll just continue to set my timer for every 20 minutes to come over, perform more stretch and folds before allowing it to do its final bulk rise. My goal with the garden this year, I've already thought this through, is to keep everything very simple. I'm not gonna grow everything and just keep what I have very tidy. So my focus is going to be on tomatoes, jalapenos, herbs, and lots and lots and lots of flowers. My thought with that, and this depends on year to year and where you are. So some years you might have more time and maybe less of a grocery budget, or maybe no access to something that you really want. In some years, you might just know that, okay, I have really great farmers in the area that I can get this, this, and this from. It's a really good price. I have little time. So I'm going to source these certain things from these certain places. Anyways, something that I can't get locally very easily or they're really expensive is fresh flowers. And we love tomatoes, so we need a lot of those. And then also fresh herbs for those daily meals, whereas like a farmer's market, you go, you stock up for the week, but you want herbs daily. That's why I chose what I chose, because I don't feel like I have the bandwidth right now to grow absolutely everything. So I focused on what seems to be the most important for our family, and I just want to do those things well. So with all that being said, before I tell you about what I'm doing here in the dinner meal, I'm going to tell you what I ordered. So I ordered Brandywine tomatoes, cosmos, a mixed sunflower seed, a couple of different zinnias. I did Queenie lime and giant lime, Oklahoma salmon. I did basil, Cherokee purple tomato, yellow Brandywine tomato, jalapeno. And then I ordered three different types of bulbs from Eden Brothers. I did the couple of Cafe Olay collections and the Cornell bronze. I've had bad luck so far with dahlias, but I think I haven't taken it very seriously. I feel like I've always been very overextended in the garden, and I really want to take flowers seriously this year because, again, I realize you can't eat flowers, but they make you so happy, and I love summer for the bouquets, and I can't get them. I can't get them every day. It's something creative that I can do, and so it's important to me. Okay, for dinner, I heated up some lard. I spread it out over Brussels sprouts and chicken. I added a maple balsamic, which is so good. Recently, a friend of mine brought to a potluck a maple balsamic Brussels sprouts, and that reminded me, like, oh, that's really good. Definitely do that. Added salt, some seasoning to the chicken, and then just put it in the oven to bake. Such an easy meal. I'm doing my final stretch and fold on the cheddar jalapeno sourdough. That's gonna go on the back of the stove and bulk ferment until bedtime. Okay, thinking back to the seeds discussion earlier, it occurred to me that I forgot to mention that I will also be purchasing some plants. So I always grow basil from seed just because it's so easy. I can throw the seeds in the ground and really have to start them inside. They take off easily. I plan to start the tomatoes indoors, but I don't want to do a whole lot of seed starting indoors this year. I just don't want to. So I will also be buying a lot more herbs. So it won't only be basil over in the herb garden. I will do my usual thyme, rosemary, cilantro. Sage will probably come back. But I wanted to mention that because I love a full herb bed. It is just not summer without all of the herbs on all the food. Okay, I wanted to show you here my panettone and how I put it in this pot to rise. So you can see that it's risen to the top. That's when you want to score it and bake it. I put it inside that pot so that way I didn't have to have any foil or plastic wrap touching the top of it, but I could keep it draft free so it didn't dry out. Going to bake it for an hour at 350 degrees and see how it turns out. I'm gonna show you that tomorrow on this video because I need to also take some photos for the blog. Okay, so to close out this day, little Danny and I are soaking some oatmeal for tomorrow. We do this to remove the phytic acid, but also it just jumpstarts breakfast prep. The boys are playing a game. We're getting some water and a bit of yogurt and oats so that we can have them soaked and ready to add a little bit more milk and cook them and add some sweetener and spices and raisins and whatnot tomorrow to have an easy breakfast. I hope that you enjoyed this video, enjoyed following along with me doing the normal and sometimes new tasks with homemaking. I like to encourage women in homemaking that it never has to be boring. There are always new things to learn and explore and get better at. There really isn't a more creative career than homemaking. You get to try so many different things. You're not limited to just one task. Sometimes I know that a lot of the tasks are very redundant and can get overwhelming and repetitive, but so much of homemaking allows us to stretch our skills, get better, and enjoy the process. If you're brand new, I would love it if you hit that subscribe button. I make new videos every week on food from scratch, natural living, and a handmade home.